So usually I'm cursed to react to new releases a bit too late, but not this time. Lauren Ashore, Cursed to Die, I'm excited. Will Ramos is a snarling, growling, demonic pioneer of deathcore vocals. Enough said, we know what it's about. I know I'm gonna dig this. The question is how much? Can it top Into the Earth for me? And if you missed that reaction, go check it out. Before we find out, subscribe, hit the bell for notifications, give this video a like, and if you want to be really awesome, check out my Patreon, linked in the description below. $2 gets you perks and bonus content, and tier 4 on there lets you make a song request, and guarantee a reaction to it as soon as possible. So if you want that kind of control during your mad quest for power, definitely check it out. And finally, if I dig this song, it's going on my groovy radioactive playlist. Alright, very excited to get into this. I need a Lorna Shore hat. If you guys know of any links where I can get one, hook me up. Like, I don't care if it's a snapback hat or what, I just need to get a Lorna Shore hat so I can start wearing one during these reactions. Anyway, Lorna Shore, Cursed to Die, official video, let's get into this in 3, 2, 1, go. I hope it's another insane video, but we'll find out. Feels kind of anthemic so far. A little power metal-esque. Subterranean growls. Okay, I'm a little bit, my mind is going in three different directions, and I love every single one of them. Because I kind of want to headbang three different ways. I want to headbang to the vocals, which are nasty as fuck. I want to headbang to the guitar. I want to headbang to the blast beats. There's so much insanity going on here, and I'm here for it all. And the video is, okay, it's nothing special so far. It's not like a story like we got last time. Like, the visuals on Into the Earth were fucking monstrous, demonic. I loved every bit of it. This is more so just the band playing, which is fine. So I'm taking this opportunity to lean even more so into the music and pay full attention to everything going on here. And so far, they're just as on point as ever. I mean, I will say that Will started it out a little bit more traditional, leading into the more traditional deathcore slash heavier metalcore-esque growls that you would expect. But then he started to get a little bit more, like I said, subterranean, very much deep from the bowels of hell styles of growls. So it's clear to me that he is going to show off his versatility here. But it's also worth noting that he's not all about just being flashy, as talented as he is. He's not just about showing off. He's about putting the vocals where they need to be and how they need to sound during the specific part of the music. So his vocals are very much fitting everything else happening here instrumentally so far. So that's the mark of a talented vocalist, when he can restrain himself and just use the growls and harshes that are necessary for the moment. Very, very cool. Let's get back to it. Drunk is punishing his hell. Okay, this is, like, relentless. This is, like, it doesn't have as much atmosphere, I would say, as the previous song, but that works for this particular song. Because this song is just going in full beast mode, 110%. Like, it's just opening the gates of hell and letting loose. It's just letting the hellfire fly, you know? I mean, it's just really, really excellent so far. I think that every song is very good at playing on and making use of the mechanics of the instrumentation, right? So this one is much more rapid fire in terms of the drumming. It's much more fast-paced in terms of the tempo, and is really leaning into that and making that work for the song. I feel like these are very smart songs, as well as being phenomenally good. And that's very important. It's the mark of a very talented band. So Lord and Shore are just tearing it up, just as excellent as always. I'm waiting for something to criticize, and I don't think it's going to happen. But I'll be honest as always, but I'm super into this. I don't know if I like it as much as Into the Earth just yet, but it's really, really killing it so far. Let's jump back in. That breakdown is filthy. This breakdown is a fucking unclean spirit. Oh, shit. This drum gets punched in the brain. Come on, Will. Head spinning around, summon the demons. Bring it. Of course there's a solo. Of course. That's surprisingly melodic. I like it. Okay. I have a feeling there's going to be a fucking crescendo that's just going to blow things up even more as the song comes to an end. So before that happens, I just got to say, this and Sun Eater and Into the Earth are all on a level of their very own. Like, it's a cut above what we've heard from Lord of Shore previously, in my humble opinion. Like, they're just fucking killing it with this. But more than that, the actual talent and the instrumental bestialness, if that's even a word, I'm making it a word. It's just amped up on these three songs. Like, this, everything I've heard from this upcoming new release is just not only fire, but an outright inferno. Like, they're just dialing things up, and dialing things up in a way that shows their evolution in musicality and talent and smartness and how the songs are put together. And I really like that Will started out this song kind of restraining himself vocally. Like, the vocals, once again, were more what I would come to expect from by the numbers deathcore. I hate using that term because it sounds insulting. I don't mean it that way, but your average deathcore. And then from there, from the midpoint of the song onward, I would say, that's when he started to dial it up and lean more into that little demon inside him. So I like that. I like that he started it out in one specific area and then kind of just expanded in different directions from there. There's so much happening here and so much more I want to say, but let's finish it up. Playlist. Just keeps going. And I spoke too soon. I seriously wish there was another minute on this. I probably always say that for this band, but just because I like it so much, you know, for the sheer epic brutalness of it all, I just wanted to keep going on for another minute or two because I was just getting so fucking into it. Needless to say, although I did say it, it's going on my Groovy Radioactive playlist. It totally deserves it. One hell of a song, man. It's not quite on the level of Into the Earth for me. That one is still my number one so far. But it's like right here, you know? Right here. Probably in line with Into... can I have a memory that works? Probably in line with Sun Eater. So those two are like right here, you know? It's a very close call. But all three of these songs have been fantastic. Just masterpieces, murder pieces, whatever you want to call them. I will say the video on this was more simplistic, more straightforward, but that's fine. Not every video has to have like a horror story attached to it. And probably they blew a lot of their budget on the last video, which was really, really great. But this video in its own right was engaging enough. I like the kind of psychedelic backdrop to the band performing. That was all fine. It was all well and good. Musically, that's the real thing I want to dig into, because I really like, once again, how Will kind of held himself back a little bit. Yeah, this is something I've said and kind of praised for many vocalists that I really like and respect. When a vocalist is truly comfortable with themselves, I think that they know how and when and where to hold themselves back. Like, okay, I'm not going to go 100% right here. I'm going to go, you know, maybe right here and wait for the right moment. Wait for the drop. Wait for the breakdown. Wait for the song to go really hard. And because of that, because he waited to just go into full demon mode, what he finally did was that much more rewarding. And it really went along with the vibe of the song, just what it needed to. So, he did a good job at building up my anticipation for him to go more savage with his harshes. And then when he finally did, there were a lot of awesome moments peppered throughout the song because of that, where he did exactly that. So I really like his vocal approach on this one. And, you know, for the record, that was one of my criticisms on, I believe, To the Hellfire. I did a reaction to that one, if you want to go back and look. One of my criticisms, I believe, of that specific song was that he did try and throw too much at the wall just to see what sticks all at the same time. Like, he was showing off his full range, and all of it was really, really fucking good. But I think it was just too much for one song. And that, combined with how it felt a little bit low in the mix, it just felt like a missed opportunity to me. But it seems like he's grown and evolved since then, very rapidly, in a very small window of time. And just since then, brought a lot more maturity and sophistication to his vocal approach. And I really have to commend him for that, because to evolve that quickly is fucking impressive, you know? And I think he's done it, and I think he's going to keep doing it. Because it clearly shows that he's willing to put in the work and the effort. I've seen some of his interviews with other channels. I've seen some of his videos about vocal approach. Like, I saw the video where he stuck a camera down his throat that he did with the charismatic voice. He's a really chill dude, but on top of that, I think that he has a mastery over his craft and a willingness not only to explore, but to use all of his various ranges of harshes for the moments in which they belong during each respective song by Lorna Shore. I think he has been learning to do that, and I think since then, the songs as a whole have improved, and he has become much better at building excitement and really strong energy for those hard drops in Lorna Shore songs. So I think all of that makes for a really, really cool process to see happening with this band as a whole. So I think the vocals were my number one thing for this. I think they were just so, so, so fucking savage. I know I keep reusing that word, but it's really so appropriate. And second, I think, would be the drumming, just because this was such a percussion-heavy song. And they all are when it comes to this band. But in certain songs, they're more pronounced, I think. Or maybe it can just seem that way if the tempo is very fast, because it feels like it goes along with the blast beats very well. Those two mesh very well together, and they make for a song that feels like it's more militant, like it's just more artillery fire heavy. And that was very much the case for this song. So I really like that it had that vibe, which kind of counters it a little bit with Into the Earth, which Into the Earth felt like it had more of a dark vibe, more of an atmosphere-oriented vibe, maybe a little bit more guitar heavy. So I like that each song kind of has its own energy so far off this release. And Sun Eater, I think, was a healthy mix between these two songs. Like, it was a mix of various styles and instrumentation that were all kind of on par with one another. So they're definitely doing their thing, and I think that the band is for sure growing musically, and it's readily apparent to anyone with ears. So I really, really like the music on this one. Probably I could say a lot more, but the point is, they brought the fire, they brought the inferno, and it's playlist worthy, to say the least. Let's get to the lyrics. Let's do the breakdown. Creations emanating between these shifting sands, the universe is turning in the palm of my hand. I will make the earth in clay, exhuming breath of life. Behold the culmination of my regrets. sentience to err as human, to forgive divine, a blessing of life, cursed to die. All will rise and fall, their flesh and bone, my sins and resolve permeate their desires. I am absolved within their design, my legacy will live on. But is it enough to satisfy my legacy? Millennia of waiting, countless years come to pass, separated from Kronos, this is my domain. I'm the face of death, my image, this eternal sin, molded from everything I hold within. We play the same keys in different times. That's a cool line. It's in our nature to die, powerless to the forces outside of our reach. I'm nothing but a man within a dream. So this is in keeping with the overall theme of the new record of self-actualized godhood. And it's a reversal of the Christian belief. So that this song is basically driving home the message of we take from our image and make that into a god. Of course, the second important part of that way of thinking is that you don't just see yourself as a god from the very beginning. You see your own godhood as the culmination of your own strength and your own intellect and potential greatness. So the idealized version of yourself that you strive to be is what defines you as a god or a goddess. It's chasing that star, that spark, and never stopping that chase. But just like Sun Eater, to me, this is about the struggle of getting from point A to point God. Because right in the opening verse, even though it describes the universe turning in the palm of his hand, in the next breath, he says, "Behold the culmination of my regrets." And then later, of course, "To err is human, to forgive is divine, a blessing of life, cursed to die." So let's break that down a bit. He's the one who determines his own course of life, and by connection, his own subjective universe. But that universe is the culmination of a life of regret for him, showing that he's still fallen short of achieving what he wants to or achieving what he originally set out to do. And then he admits that to err is to be human, but to forgive oneself is the mark of someone inherently divine. And he also recognizes the power and greatness of his life, but at the same time, is lamenting the fact that at some point it will end. So it's like the struggle of striving for apotheosis within the confines and limitations of one's own life and universe, and against the backdrop of this looming inevitability. And I really like that perspective because it's a very vulnerable and very cogitative examination of your own strength. Because there's this false idea, I think, that when someone is really strong and really in touch with their inner strength, and they've got a lot of control and mastery over what's going on in their lives, then that somehow means that their life is going really great, or that they don't have sadness or frustration. And that's just not true. Being in touch with who you are and controlling the direction of your life, those are both great things. But by no means are they the signs of perfection or happiness. They're just one very important step in a continuous climb up the ladder to Elysium, to use the Greek concept as metaphor here. And along the way, there are struggles. There's absolute difficulty and hardship and pain. And being able to competently and wisely navigate yourself to a particular point in life doesn't mean that it's going to be a good point. It just means that you got there on your own, that you had the pride and the responsibility to have gotten yourself there rather than be dragged there by someone else or by a situation or rather than letting the random tides of life just toss you back and forth aimlessly and just having the attitude of, oh, wherever I land is wherever I land. Instead, it's like, no, I'm going to draw a line in the sand very clearly right here and now and have the self-determination and the personal responsibility to say, this is where I want to be. And these are the steps that I need to take to get myself there. And for better or worse, it's going to be of my own choosing. So, you know, and there's absolute merit in that personal autonomy. But it's also not some magical key to automatic happiness or success. And I think in this person's moment of anger and frustration, and maybe even a moment of doubt, they're seeing that truth as a harsh one, and maybe a very hard pill to swallow. But judging by the song title, the biggest underlying factor here is the fact that this person knows their life will eventually end. And maybe that makes him feel even more defeated when he hasn't gotten his life exactly how he wants it. He feels that his own finite existence has put an unfair limitation or handicap on his path toward godhood. Although, it's worth noting that in some cultures, there was a thought of apotheosis actually happening to someone after the end of their natural life. The Greek and Roman ideas of it, for example, often involved the canonization of legendary figures as gods after they had lived out their human lives. In very ancient Rome, for example, if I'm remembering correctly, you had Quirinus, who was a religious military leader, at least in myth, if not in reality. And subsequently, Quirinus was idolized as a god after death, although he didn't really make it into the larger Roman pantheon, where god and goddess-based cults tended to dominate, so he kind of faded into obscurity at a certain point. But the example still stands. So that was one belief, and it makes it interesting when compared with the belief here, one which I would tend to agree with, that someone is perfectly capable of achieving apotheosis while they're here in this world. Like I always say, it's your own inner strength that lets you better yourself. Because think about it. Whenever we're feeling down or depressed or defeated, even if the advice or influence of others might help us, in fact, sometimes might play a very important role, it takes our own ideas, our own vision, our own plans to forge a path out of that darkness and into a place in life where we better ourselves and become more powerful. We may definitely be influenced by others and by everything around us, but the real catalyst for change exists within, and it comes from the actualization of ideals that we hold in our own minds, which is the same reason that people who pray are misplacing the catalyst for their lives, being improved. It's not some external deity that's helping someone when they pray. It's that person, unbeknownst to them, but it's that person who's channeling their own inner strength to bring about the change that they want. They're just misattributing the source of that change because they've been indoctrinated to believe that they're subordinate and subservient to some greater almighty force or figure, when in fact, the strength was in them all along. But knowing you have that ability, I could see how it would then become all the more frustrating to know that you have a limited time here to experience life the way that you really want to and to really forge that path for yourself when you know that there's an end in sight. You don't know how, you don't know when, but you know that it's inevitability. But, you know, the way to grapple with that, I would say, is that ultimately you just have to make the most of your time here and do the best that you possibly can. And if you can do that, then you really shouldn't have any room for regret. And death in that context would only be a curse if you let it linger over you like a dark cloud. And a lot of people do. But if you can escape from it and keep building your life as you see fit, it may take time, but you can get out from under that darkness. So that's my little take on it, of course, my unsolicited advice. Always an expected part of these reactions. But so lyrically, it does fit into the overarching concept, I think, on this new release. I think that I prefer Into the Earth lyrically over this one, but this one is still pretty well written. But more so than that, I really like the music on this. Again, vocals and percussion were my big takeaways. They completely dominated the song and made it just one hell of a militant, infernal masterpiece. Very strong, 11 out of 12 on the Doomsday Clock. It's almost a 12. It's that fucking good. And that's it. My review, my reaction, my breakdown. If you made it this far, I really appreciate that. Hit subscribe on your way out the door. Give this video a like. Hit the bell for notifications. Check out my Patreon. If you want that VIP access and want to control some of what you see on this channel, that's how you do it. Much more content on the way. Much love and respect to the nuclear family, and I will catch you all on the next one.